This session tonight will be the first session in breaking away from the series that we have been doing in the for the last few months, where we were conducting the series on the Sirah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now this session, the Saturday night session, I will begin a new series which I have begun last time, and I will repeat that tonight. I began this with the sisters, and that's the reason tonight we are combining the brothers and the sisters so that we have a more constructive session. And the plan is to go through the sequence of Islam now, not the sequence of the Sirah, meaning what is the foundation upon which we build our Islam? What is that foundation? In fact, if the Iman is the Aqidah, as a foundation, if that is not settled, then anything you build on top of that is not going to be settled. So I'm planning to go through this series of sessions explaining the significance of the Aqidah, the impact of it, the meaning of it, the evidences and the proof, if you will, on all types of Aqidah, things which some people sometimes hesitate to talk about or take it for granted when they, in reality they are not, and how this Aqidah can impact our life, how does it motivate me or you to go and attend a session on Islam 30 minutes away from here, how, why would the issues of the, why do the issues of Jannah and Jahannam, we see sometimes they motivate you or her but does not motivate me, why is it sometimes I would prefer to spend the time with my kids or with my wife or with my family, and not only that, but to go to the extreme of committing haram for the sake of my beloved children and family, when this very children and very family does not save my skin in the judgment. Why does it happen? Why sometimes I do prefer and give attachment, loyalty to my tribe, to my nation, to my nationalism, to my flag, or the flag that has been given to me. And when it comes to Islam and to sacrifice for Islam per se, only for Islam, for La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, we find some hesitation. Why these questions take place and how we overcome this issue? Why sometimes you put in front of the Ummah big task and you put some serious problems. I mean, you lay down the issues of race among Muslim women all over the world. You put among the Muslim Ummah in front of their eyes land which has been occupied, confiscated. You put in front of the eyes of the Muslim Ummah, the Muslim men and women, the fact that Islam is not being implemented, that Allah Azza wa Jal, His authority in this world has been challenged by the kuffar, by the ones who are worth it or don't worth it. You put all these issues, and then it could motivate me to maybe give you or give myself a bit of my emotion, if you will, to be angry for a minute, to be mad for a second, to be sad for an hour, or maybe to contribute a penny or a dollar or $1,000 for the next hour. But then after that, beyond that, I go back to my normal cycle of life. What's going on? Why all of this? Why all these issues is taking place? Why, as even when we talked about in the Sirah, I'm going to use that, although I'm not continuing with the Sirah, but I have to use the information which I have learned in the past few months. When I read and look into the history and the biography of a person like Bilal radiallahu anhu. Biography of a man who once was a slave, who knew nothing but to tell his master, yes sir. Umayyah bin Khalaf and Bani Jumah, he would follow the kid. If his kid was a master, and he would tell him, let's go to the spring of water and bring some couple of buckets of water. And of course Bilal would carry them on their back, on his back, while the kid is riding the camel or the horse. He would have done that, and he used to do that. But then out of a sudden, Bilal disobeys Umayyah and revolts against his rule and stands up tall to the tyranny of Umayyah, and he threatens the threat for his own life does not scare him a bit. Drives in the desert on a daily basis, tortured. We've gone over that. But then at the end of the day, he stands tall and he says, Ahad, Ahad, what is it that went into the heart of Bilal that converted him from a slave to the people to a slave to Allah Azza wa Jalla alone? What is it? What type of magic? Of course, the people used to call it magic at the time. And Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَمَا هُوَ بِقَوْلِ سَاحِرِ It's not a sahir, he's not magic. Well, when the people of Quraysh, they saw a person like Bilal being converted overnight, they said, this man must have displayed magic on him. When they saw Nuwayra or Zinnira or one of the other women slaves at the time revolting against their own masters, like Sumayya, what type of magic did Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam play on them? Allah Azza wa Jalla says, look, he doesn't play magic. Then what is it? If it's not magic, if it's not that touch, as the Christians, they call it the touch of the Christ or the touch of the priest or the touch of a holy person, it's not the touch. Because if it was the touch, then he would have touched his ankle, Abu Talib. And once he touched his ankle and he liked his ankle to become like Bilal or even better, it didn't work, that touch. So it definitely it's not the touch. And certainly, it is not the reading of the Qur'an, because that Qur'an was being read to Abu Jahl and to Umayya bin Khalaf and to Al-Akhnas. You all remember, I think I mentioned this a couple of weeks ago when I was speaking in one of the last sessions in the Seerah, where some of these elites of Mecca would go and listen to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they would listen all night until Fajr comes up, and they used to listen to the Qur'an. And then when they go home, and of course they find each other, the same guys who conspire against Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and tell the people not to listen to Muhammad, they were listening to him, and at the end of the day they did not believe. And Abu Jahl made his famous statement, Wallahi lanuqatilannahu hatta yahlakam. Wallah, by Allah, we will fight him until he dies, until we destroy him. So that reading of the Quran that came through from the mouth of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not the issue either. Because if it was the issue, then Abu Jahl and Al-Akhnas and Abu Sufyan and the big elite would have become Muslims at the time. And then the Muslims didn't have to suffer. So there must be something else. What is it that something else? What is that else? That's what we will be going through in these consecutive sessions. Evidently, the only thing that changed for Bilal or Abu Bakr or Hamza or Mus'ab or Talha or Arqam or Az-Zubayr or any of these, name the names you want, or Yasir or Sumayya or Ammar or any of them, the only thing that changed was really that concept which we call, which people call today, the Iman, and Allah Azza wa Jalla called it Iman. It's that switch of belief from believing that there are gods or there are no gods. There are gods other than Allah Azza wa Jalla. People could be gods or Rabb. Rabb means master, sovereign, or idol can be gods or representatives of gods, or cows, if you will, or horses, or elephants, or women or men of all types of kinds and genders could be gods. That was the issue. And that was the driving force behind the people, and that's how they lived. And out of a sudden, there is something new. The belief that only one God that controlled the world from the beginning, from the time of its creation. From the time of the creation, Allah Azza wa Jal, there is a God behind that. And the life that exists within me, my very life, when I say the life exists in me, the life that makes me talk now. If I die, I cannot talk anymore. The senses, the ability for me to listen, that's a sensing. Now if I die, I will not be able to listen or to hear. وَمَا أَنْتَ بِمُسْمِعٍ مَّنْ فِي الْقُبُورِ Allah says, you are not going to make the people who are in the graves listen. They don't hear. Once you die, you don't hear. Now the very life in me that allows me to talk now, or to listen, or even to rationalize what I am talking, or to think about it, or to think whether I will take it seriously, or I will say, well, it's just a talk. Anyone can talk like this, who cares? This very ability comes from your life, the fact that you are a living being. Because you have life, therefore you have a brain that functions, you have a heart that pumps, you have the blood that goes in your veins, you have muscles that make your hands move, you have hair that you can comb or move around. The life that is within you, those people, Mufab and Bilal and Abu Bakr, realize that this life is from Allah Azza wa Jal. This life, there is someone behind it. There is someone behind the fact that I can do service to Umayyah. And that's Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah Azza wa Jal is behind the fact that I am able to provide service now. Allah, there is a creator, there is a God who is behind the fact that I can listen to you if you tell me a command or order. There is a God, there is Allah who allows me to respond to a command of a tyrant. If I am a soldier or a policeman and the king tells me go and arrest someone, there is Allah Azza wa Jal, a God who made me able to do that. But this very Allah, this very same God, is telling me, from now on, you've got to receive commands from me. This is the concept. This is the very concept. It's a switch between the belief that there are many people, or many idols, or many things, or many entities, or many elites, that can have a control over my sovereignty, a control over my body, over my life. This is one side, or the side, be it another entity called Allah Azza wa Jal or the God. That is the very concept that came into the heart of some of the people in Mecca, converted them towards that what they have become. Nothing else. It was not the reading of the Quran per se. Not the reading. It is the Quran which contains concepts, ideas and thoughts that convince their mind. Yes. It is the Quran and the words of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that made sense to the one who is thinking, who is making sense out of issues. Yes, it is the substance that was included in the word اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. You read after all in the name of the Rabb who created, not the Rabb who doesn't create. Well, after all, people, they do have Rabb. Everybody would have a Rabb at any point of time. Everybody has a Rabb. You either have Allah as your Rabb or someone else. You do not live without Rabb. There is no single person, there is no single creature, there is no single entity in the world that does not have a Rabb. If you don't have Allah as your Rabb, then you will have someone else. Your father, your parents, your leader, your king, your desires. رأيت من اتبع هواه? Have you seen the one who follows his own hawa, his own desire? اتخذ إلهه هواه. He took his God as his own hawa. So even if you don't have an element outside you that's a Rabb, then you will be the Rabb of your own self. So at any point of time, each one would have a Rabb, whether you like it or not. If it's not Allah Azza wa Jal, the creator, then you have to think and find out who's your Rabb. Dig deep and you will find him. People who listen and to obey and obey to the systems of the Taghut, their Rabb is the Taghut. Allah waliy الذين آمنوا يخرجهم من الظلمات إلى النور والذين كفروا أولياؤهم الطاغوت. And the kuffar, their wali, their allies, the synonym of Allah Azza wa Jal is a Taghut. And the Taghut is either a system that practices, that preaches oppression, or if it's a person or an entity that actually implements oppression. Everybody has a Rabb at each point. So what came into Mecca at that time, what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought, what Allah gave Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to bring to the world, is that very first concept. اقرأ بسم ربك. Read in the name of your Rabb, الذي خلق. The one who created. That's the bottom line. The Rabb is the one who created. That's very concept. That's very concept. Which was not even seconded by many ideas. The only concept. All the other concepts that came later, they were just expanding on it. رب المشارق والمغارب. Your Rabb, he is the Rabb of the Eastern Horizons and the Western Horizons. رب المشرق والمغرب. The Rabb of the Mashriq and the Maghrib. رب العالمين. The Rabb of all the world. Expanding on this issue. Who is Allah? And where his dominance is, where is his domain? But this very concept, once it enters my brain, and I take it, and I make that click like the click of the mouse, which brings all routines in my brain, and out of a sudden I start functioning on this frequency of Allah is my Rabb. So there are two frequencies I can function on, two domains I can live in. Either the domain of Allah Azza wa Jal being the Rabb, and I realize that I live in His house, I live in His earth, I live in His solar system, I live in His universe, and the life within me is His, and the fact that I speak today is because of Allah Azza wa Jal. Either I have this domain, or I don't, or I live in another domain. I live in the domain of my hawa, my desires. I want to seek every desire I have. I want to go after every woman I can see. I will walk, I will go after every single penny, halal or haram. I will implement and invest in every aspect of life in order to increase my wealth. That's my domain. That's one domain, which is I follow whatever comes, whatever makes at least appeals to me. That's one domain, or the domain of Rabbi alladhi khalaq. Whether we like it or not, what has made the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is nothing but this very concept. It is not the magic. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam does not play magic. It is not this spiritual type of reading and environment that surrounds the Quran when someone like Abdul Basit or Qusayri reads it. After all, as I said, some people, they listened it coming from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam directly from his mouth, and it did not really touch their heart. It made them more tyrant, it made them more taghiya, like Abu Jahl and Umayyah and then the Abu Lahab and even Abu Talib. That said, remained as is. They did not even change a single hair in their body, did not move them. So what really moves the people is their realization. Once you realize that who my Rabb is, who my God is, to whom my worship is, that isn't this what we say, isn't this the prerequisite of becoming a Muslim? La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. When somebody accepts Islam, and some of us here are Muslims, they have come into Islam, and when somebody says, what do I have to do to become Muslim? Oh, la ilaha illallah. Meaning what? Negating all gods. La ilaha negates every single God. There is no God. Not myself, not my wife, not my parents, not my king, not my master, not the United Nations, not the Security Council, not Hussein, not Assad, not this, not that. None of these are God. None of these, absolutely. None of these means God. God means He has authority over me. That's what it means. None of these has a say into my life. None of these can scare me or frighten me from within. None of these can impact my life. Look at this, none of these, because they are not God, and therefore once you reject Him as a God, therefore He has no authority over my very life. He may have an authority over a chair to move, over something, but He has no authority over my life. My life is, or has, the only one who has authority over my life is the one who created it. These gods whom I am negating, they do not control the air I breathe. The air that I breathe, Allah Azza wa Jal created. Show me what they have created. أروني ماذا خلق الذين من دونه. Show me what they have created. The water I drink, Allah Azza wa Jal has created. The God, this God which I am claiming now, إلا الله, لا إله إلا الله, Allah is the one who created the water for me. I drink this water, and therefore He is my God. He has authority over my water. The world that produces food, how is the food produced? Many people, many among us here probably have studied farming or agriculture. How is food produced? You think the tractor produces the food? Who makes the nitrogen go inside the ground, inside the dirt and the soil? Goes deep inside, and then these roots of the trees, they go and look for all these nitrogen, oxygen, carbon, dissolved within water, or all these minerals. Who makes that mix inside the ground? Doesn't Allah Azza wa Jal even remind us about that? He, Allah Azza wa Jal, أَرْسَى فِيهَا جَعَلَ فِي الْأَرْضِ رَوَاسِيَ وَأَنْهَارِ. He made rivers in the ground, and then He talks in the next ayah how Allah Azza wa Jal created jannat And then they feed from the same water, from the same ground, and they have different tastes, and they taste differently in Surah Fatir or Surah Ar-Rajj, where Allah Azza wa Jal talks about this, how He created Jannat and some food that they differ in their taste. Who does that? It's Allah Azza wa Jal. Now, if I realize this fact, and therefore Allah becomes my God and my Rabb, and indeed this is true, then of course, what has happened to Mus'ab should happen to me. Mus'ab is no better than me. In creation, Allah created Mus'ab the same way He created me. Allah never said that He created the people, the Muslims who were in Mecca at the time, from a certain clay, and the rest of the world are created from different clay. Never said that. He never said that there are certain people who have genes different from the others. That's what the scientists trying to prove sometimes, and they all the time they come to the one and only one fact. The thing that makes you behave in a manner rather than a certain other manner is what you believe. It's not what you eat, as some people say, you are what you eat. It's you are what you believe. Not what you eat, not what you dress, not what you look like, not what your language is, not what your blood is. It's what you believe. And Allah Azza wa Jal did not create the people differently. The same creation that was applied to the Muslims at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam still applies to us today. The same type of creation. And when Allah says, أَلَمْ نَجْعَلْ لَهُ عَيْنَيْنِ وَلِسَانًا وَشَفَتَيْنِ, didn't we make two eyes for him and a tongue and two lips? That applies to Abu Jahl and to Hamza and to Abu Talib and to Mus'ab and to me and to you and to Asad and to Hussein and to Fahd and to Clinton. Everybody has the same thing. So what makes a difference then? What really made those people different is what has come into their brain and the fact that they have accepted. That's what made the difference. So today, when we stand in front of the issues that are facing us, and we find ourselves being pulled down to the earth so that we don't really stand up to our activities or to our duties and responsibilities. When we find out sometimes I hesitate to act upon this iman that is in my heart. When I find myself that I barely move, either to dress Islamically if I was a sister, or to pray, or to fast, or to pay my zakah, or to make amr bil ma'roof, enjoin what's good, or forbid what's evil, or to stand up to the tyrants who don't want to see Islam being implemented. Whenever I see myself in this position, what is it that's pulling me down? Why this iman is not really impacting me? Why this iman is not impacting many people around us? Why this iman is not moving the 1.9 billion people today to present to the world the best model of life Allah wanted on this earth? Why? Why you find hundreds of millions of people are willing to fight for nationalism, like in Pakistan, or like in Palestine, or like in Kashmir, or like in Caucasus, but they may or are not willing even to think about fighting for Islam per se. Islam meaning making the word of Allah the supreme. I'm not talking about liberating the land. Everybody fights to liberate his land, even the birds. Even the birds try to go and destroy the nest of an eagle. He may kill you. An eagle, it's a bird. An eagle, once you catch him and you tie him, you find he has nothing. Absolutely nothing but his strong mouth, what do you call this, his teeth? What's that? Okay, whatever. I still even cannot see myself. Even the eagle will fight you. The lion, the bird, the ants. If anybody has tried at some point to disperse ants from their home, they fight. They fight back, but of course you crush them with your foot because you are tyrant, as far as they are concerned. And remember what the ant told their ادخلوا مساكنكم لا يحطمنكم سليمان وجنده. Go to your houses so سليمان and soldiers will not crush you. Okay, well, سليمان and the soldiers are too powerful for the ants, but still they want to stay in their homes. Everybody fights for his land. Believe me. But the issue is, the Muslims today, we have not grown up to the level of what the Iman called for. The Iman is calling for negating all gods, all Rabs in the world and establishing the fact that Allah is the only God and the only Rabb. That's what our Iman is calling for. And in order to do that, there are many, many challenges that stand in front of our way. How do we acquire that belief and that Iman? That's the main question. That's the question that we have to address it to ourselves and to address it to the people around us, and we have to come back to the conclusion. Is it true, the fact that I have inherited my Iman from my parents, or I have taken it from someone who transferred it to me through certain discussions or arguments, is that Iman that I have really establishes a fact in my mind and in my heart that the very water that's in front of me is indeed from Allah Azza wa Jal, and if Allah desires so, I would not be able to drink it right now? Do I really have that? Do I really see the fact that Allah Azza wa Jal is behind every single move in this world? Or I don't? Do I really see and believe and accept and understand even like when Bilal was being hit by the stick of Umayyah, that this very stick that he is using against him is the creation of Allah Azza wa Jal, so that reminds him of Allah more than it makes him feel the pain of Umayyah. That very fact, which we have to go through in series of discussions and the sessions here in this Saturday night, inshallah, and we will provoke the audience for the questions and the answers, at least to be able to understand whether these facts are very well realized in our hearts and our minds, and that we can act upon them. And as I have mentioned already, that this Iman, it must have the impact no less than it had on any of the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as far as the impact is concerned. Now, the level of the Sahaba being praised by Allah Azza wa Jal, that's a different story. We're not getting into that. Allah Azza wa Jal praised them. They were the first to accept and the first to fight for it. Well, they were the ones who were in the forefront. But now, we have at least have the example of them. They did not have an example in front of them. We have the example of the Sahaba and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we have the definition. We have all the Quran in front of us. We have all of Islam in front of us. At the time, they didn't have it all. What they only had, few surahs revealed, I mean, even until the migration to Medina, most of the Quran was not revealed at the time. If you read Al-Baqarah, Al-Imran, Al-Nisa alone, they make up for the majority of the Quran, which were revealed in Medina. All of these were not revealed yet. So what they had then, the only thing they had at the time is their ability to see facts as is. To see the fact as is without any hesitation, without the pollution, without the impurities that come to it. They would see the fact as is and understand it, comprehend it, think about it, and believe it. So that's what they had of them. Today we have more. Today we have the example of someone who has done it before me. I have my brain. I have all of Islam which is already revealed.
We know that when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam received the revelation, Allah Azza wa Jal was giving him a message which is based on the belief in Allah Azza wa Jal, based on the foundation of Islam, the aqidah of Islam, that Allah is the creator, Allah is the Rabb, Allah is the sovereign, Allah is the ruler, and that there will be a day of judgment, and that there will be accountability, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah, and that the Quran is the word of Allah. This foundation was being given and to be established. How Allah Azza wa Jal was treating this subject in the Quran, and how Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam responded to this treatment is very crucial. So what I will do in this session and the coming session is to really follow the sequence, to look how this Quran initially was looking at this very important subject. And without going into too much of the history, because I have spoken about that in the past, it seems that there were stages, as much as there were stages in the da'wah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I've spoken about the stages of the da'wah when I was talking about the seerah, and in addressing the issue of the aqidah, there were stages. I was looking at the very first surahs, probably the first 10 or 15 surahs. And the issues of the aqidah which were addressed in these surahs, they make one assumption. Allah Azza wa Jal, in this ayah, in this surah, is making an assumption to the people that, look, there is no dispute about the fact that Allah is a creator and Allah is a God. That is not a dispute. And Allah is giving the Quran and using this as a fact without even considering the argument or a debate on whether this issue is accepted, believed by or not. And if you will, let me go through some of these earlier surahs, just quick sequence, and I encourage everyone just to take this surah or these ayahs one more time and examine them. You will find, for example, first surah, Allah Azza wa Jal is telling Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق. Read in the name of your Rabb who created. He does not go into the argument or the proof whether his Rabb, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Rabb of Muhammad, is a creator or not. This comes later. Later on in Surah Ar-Rum, if you will, in Surah Al-Isra, in Surah Al-A'raf, which were revealed much, much more later, where Allah Azza wa Jal starts saying, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ, among his signs, among the evidences. But right there, pay attention to this. And by the way, I would like this session to be interactive. If you have something that you don't get it, you don't understand it, you want to question, immediately point it at me. It's not, otherwise I will keep talking. I will not run out of subject. But if you find something is not understood, or I'm not making sense for you, just bring the issue immediately. So now, going back to the subject, Allah Azza wa Jal is saying, اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق, خلق الإنسان من علق. Read in the name of your Rabb who created, and he created the human from a clot of blood. A fact. It's a fact. Allah Azza wa Jal is stating it as a fact. And the issue here is that Allah Azza wa Jal is the Rabb of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the rest of the surah talks about interaction. What happens if someone does not accept Muhammad, the Rabb of Muhammad, as a Rabb? An issue will be, there is a debate and there is an argument and there is an attack. Other surahs, in Surah Al-Muzzammil, Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَذْكُرِ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ وَتَبَتَّلْ إِلَيْهِ تَبْتِيلًا. Mention the name of your Rabb, Allah. Bring it up, tell the people, my Rabb is Allah Azza wa Jal. اذكر اسم ربك. The name of your Rabb, who is the name of the Rabb of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Allah. You tell them, my Rabb is Allah Azza wa Jal. My Rabb is not Hubal, my Rabb is not Allah. My Rabb is Allah Azza wa Jal. That's what Allah is telling Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's not encouraging or telling Muhammad or instigating him to enter into an argument with the people whether my Rabb is Allah or my Rabb is someone else. Just mention that and go and move. So move. Just like now, I will tell a society, if I'm making a da'wah from today or starting, look, my Rabb is Allah Azza wa Jal. My legislator is Allah Azza wa Jal. Whether you like it or not. That's what I am about. That's what my message is about. That's what my da'wah is about. It's Allah Azza wa Jal. I'm establishing the fact that I believe in. Whether you take it or you don't take it, that's a different story. This is how the Quran is approaching. Look at the next surah, Surah Al-Muddathir, where Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. He does not get into an argument whether my Rabb is great or not. Your Rabb is great, period. This is an approach. This is a methodology of treating the subject. Now here is a subject which I believe in. It's aqeedah that I believe in. It's Allah Azza wa Jal. I take him as a Rabb. I have no problem with this. And then I will present it to you, assuming that you don't have a problem with it. Assuming that this is Allah. I'm talking about the Allah that you know. I'm talking about the Creator that you know is the Creator. Now once you start debating this issue, once you start telling me, oh wait a second, after all I don't know this Allah, after all I don't think there is a Creator, then it becomes a different story. But for the beginning, and look at this sequence of the surahs, Surah Iqra, first surah, Allah is mentioning this, Iqra bismi rabbik, read in the name of your Rabb, period, no argument. Wadhkur isma rabbik, mention the name of your Rabb, no argument whatsoever. وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ, your Rabb glorify, no argument whatsoever. And later on, one or two surahs ahead, there is Surah Al-Fatiha, comes immediately next, and Allah states facts. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Malik Yawm Al-Din. Stating facts about Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah is my Rabb, Rabbil Alameen, Rahman Ar-Rahim, Malik Yawm Al-Din, the owner of the Day of Judgment, the accountability. إياك نعبد, إياك نستعين, all worship to Allah Azza wa Jal, and so on. And there are more details into this. If anybody is interested into the details, you go back to the tapes of the tafsir, which we have. Then, in the next surah, سبح اسم ربك الأعلى. In a surah al-A'la, again from the earlier surahs, سبح, glorify the name of your Rabb, who is the higher. الذي خلق فسوى. He created and he made his creation perfect. He perfected his creation. No argument. Stating facts. If anybody has an argument, bring it up. Anybody claims atheism, is an atheist, says, I don't believe that there is a creator, let's see. But as long as this does not come up, as long as this does not come up in the discussion, which means people have no dispute with this issue, you continue basing on this. Okay, if you don't have any dispute, then Allah, who is Rabbul A'la, then he has got to be worshipped. سبح اسم ربك الأعلى. Glorify the name of your Rabb, who is the higher. الذي خلق فسوى. No argument. In Surah Al-Layl, which comes about two surahs ahead from Al-A'la, والليل إذا يغشى, and Allah is swearing by the night, when the night comes over and comes by and takes over. والنهار إذا تجلى, and by the daytime, when the daytime takes over. وما خلق الذكر والأنثى, and by the fact that he created the male and the female. The creation, again, Allah created, no argument, no dispute. The issue is not subject to debate. I am presenting ideas, alaykum as-salam, I am presenting the ideas, presenting my aqeedah, presenting my faith, presenting the basis and the foundation upon which I am building this faith, and I am not even accepting debate. This is not the issue of the debate. You go through these surahs, and by the way, these took about the first 2 years of the da'wah. These surahs were still concentrating and making sure that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not engaging in a debate about these issues, whether they are facts or not. They are being given as facts. Now what do I gather from here? I gather from this. When I want to present the ideas about Islam to a society, to a community, or to us, the ideas are based on this belief that Allah Azza wa Jal is the Rabb, He is the Creator, and He is to be worshipped. And I will present these ideas. If you have no issue at all. I mean, it does not come to your mind that you don't accept Allah being a God. If that doesn't come up, I'm not going to bring it up for you. If you don't have a dispute within your own brain, within your own mind, I'm not going to bring this dispute. The only thing I will bring now is why you are not acting upon this fact. What is it that's keeping you? What is it that's making you challenge the order and the laws of Allah Azza wa Jalla? In fact, this is evident from the arguments and the debates that were brought in the Quran by Allah Azza wa Jalla at that stage. I'm still at that earlier stage of the presentation of the Aqeedah. So this issue of the Aqeedah, which we talked about last time, there is a methodology of presenting it. There is a method. The Quran has a method. First, establishing the fact as it. Once these facts are clear, then he goes to the next stage. And while building that foundation, while making sure that everybody knows what the facts are, there are issues to be argued with. There are arguments, there are debates. And these debates have to do with why the people are not responding positively to the fact that Allah Azza wa Jal is the only Rabb to be obeyed. For example, look at the Surah Al-Qalam, which is one of the earlier ones. Some of the narrators claim that it is the second surah after Al-Alaq. Some say it's after Muddathir and Muzammil. So in either case, it's one of the first four surahs. So it was not revealed much later, it was revealed earlier. Allah Azza wa Jal is talking about the kuffar when the kuffar had some issues of responding to the da'wah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look what, how the Quran addresses this. أَمْ لَكُمْ كِتَابٌ فِيهِ تَدْرُسُونَ إِنَّ لَكُمْ لَمَا تَخَيَّرُونَ. Or maybe the reason you are not responding to the da'wah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you are not following him, you are not believing what he wants you to believe in, is because you have another book that you are reading from. You have another reference. The fact that Allah Azza wa Jal is a God, is a creator, that it's okay, it's a side issue, but your main issue is that you have some other reference. If that's the case, let's look at it. Let's see that book. Similarly, I'll take this for today's conditions and today's da'wah issues and today's message. When you present the ideas of Islam, you say, look, people, Islam has got to be followed. The rules of Islam, the laws of Islam, the systems of Islam have got to be implemented. Islam has got to be taken seriously. And then you'll find some people putting this aside. Sisters not adhering to the Islamic code of dress, brothers are not doing their hajj or doing their zakah, people are not doing their jihad, they are not enjoining what's good, they are not forbidding what's evil, they are not rulers are not ruling by Islam, people calling for democracy, people are voting for kuffar or whoever. All of this is taking place, then you will say, wait a second, maybe you have another reference besides this Quran. This Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ tells me that this is not approved what you are doing. Maybe you have another book. Maybe you have another reference. That's what the Quran was arguing with the people at the time. Maybe you have a book. أَمْ لَكُمْ كِتَابٌ فِيهِ تَدْرُسُونَ. The other ayah, أَمْ لَكُمْ أَيْمَانٌ عَلَيْنَا بَالِغَةٌ إِلَى يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ إِنَّ لَكُمْ لَمَا تَحْكُمُونَ. لَمَا تَحْكُمُونَ. Or maybe that you have made some contracts and deals with Allah behind my back. Here Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam telling the kuffar of Mecca, look, oh, the reason probably you are not responding to this da'wah and you are not listening to me and you are not following what I'm saying, maybe you already made a deal with Allah Azza wa Jal from behind my back, something I don't know about. Maybe you guys, you have done something, you have looked into this Islam and you found some ahkam or some rules that take you straight away to Jannah without having to abide by the laws of riba, without having to refrain from zina, without having to implement Islam, without having to dress Islamically, without having to pray, you have your own way to Jannah. Maybe that's, if that's the case, let's know. Let us know about that. This is the methodology of the Quran of debating the issue of the Aqeedah. Maybe you have another source. And Allah Azza wa Jal is telling Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the only source I am giving you is this Quran. These people don't have anything. سلهم أيهم بذلك زعيم. يسأل محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. Ask them who claims this. Who has a claim that he can take the people straight to Jannah without following this path? أم لهم شركاء؟ فليأتوا بشركائهم إن كانوا صادقين. Or maybe they have partners. Partners who help them and support them. Look at this argument. These are arguments. When the Quran says am, or is it that, or maybe that, or it's possible that, this is an argument. It's a debate. And Allah Azza wa Jal is stating that in the Quran, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is using it as a methodology. That's what it is. But this methodology is not questioning so far, it's not questioning the belief in Allah as a creator. Look, even when he says, أَمْ لَكُمْ أَيْمَانٌ عَلَيْنَا بَالِغَةٌ إِلَى يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ إِنَّ لَكُمْ لَمَا تَحْكُمُونَ. This means it's assuming that you have covenant and deal with Allah Azza wa Jal, meaning that you don't question Allah. You have no question about Allah Azza wa Jal and about His existence. You only question deals and the covenant and the path that takes you to Allah Azza wa Jal or to the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jal. It's very interesting way of putting the ideas of the Aqeedah. Very important to understand that, so that in our approach with ourselves and with the people, we don't step there. We don't go to the next step, to the second stage before we actually fulfill that. You first establish these facts. Give them as is. These are my facts. And the people, at first glance, they will not come to question the basis. People don't, will not question the basis, will not come and tell you right from the very beginning, look, even this whole issue of Islam, we don't accept it. In reality, that's the case. We have never seen in our arguments, in our debates, in our da'wah, in our interactions with the people, that the people come and say, look, this whole Islam is not accepted. This whole Allah of yours, this God, this creator of yours, we don't even care about. They don't say that. But later on, they might. There is a time where you really push the people to the limit once they start questioning these bases. But you don't start questioning the bases until there is enough environment and conditions for that. Similarly, along these lines, I'll just give more examples so that this becomes really very well understood. In Surah Takwir, one of the earlier surahs, one of the first 10 surahs which were revealed in Mecca, where Allah says, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, إذا الشمس كورت وإذا النجوم انكدرت وإذا الجبال سيرت وإذا العشار عطلت وإذا الوحوش حشرت وإذا الجبال سيرت. Before I translate, Allah is talking about events of the day of judgment as if they are happening. When the sun collapses, when the stars fall down, when the mountains move or get moved, when the animals and the wealth are left behind, when the wild animals and the people get together, when the seas explode. Allah Azza wa Jal is putting it as something as a fact. He's not even questioning that. And he is not waiting for the people to say whether this is correct or not. That's not even a subject of debate. Absolutely. It is a fact of matter. And Allah is talking about the day of judgment as a fact. Not subject for questioning. Now if somebody doesn't believe in that, that comes later. But this is what Allah is using even as a premise, as a foundation, as a basis for issuing another fact. When he says, إِنَّهُ لَقَوْلُ رَسُولٍ كَرِيمٍ, it's indeed a statement of an honorable messenger. Ujjal is stating there, he's making it as a fact about the events of the Day of Judgment. That's not even subject of debate. And the only way you would confirm this is only if you believe that Allah Azza wa Jal is the creator, He is a God, and this Quran is from Allah Azza wa Jal, and Allah is speaking the truth. That's not even a subject of debate. And of course, Allah establishes a fact based on these events. By this swear, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ وَإِذَا النُّجُومُ كَدَرَتْ إِنَّهُ لَقَوْلُ رَسُولٍ كَرِيمٍ. Indeed, it is the statement of an honorable messenger. Now, having said that, that did not stay for long. This issue, this methodology, or this first stage went for some time, maybe for a year, for 2 years, little or more, but there were about 10 to 12 or to 15 surahs of the earlier revelation is making this push, this momentum from Allah Azza wa Jalla and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and not accepting any debate and any question about whether Allah Azza wa Jalla is indeed a creator and a God or not. But that did not go for long. There comes the next stage. A stage which begins, if you will, if you look at the Quran, if you open it, Surah Al-Mursalat, that's the first time where Allah Azza wa Jalla starts hinting and giving these evidences that, look, let's go back now to question basis number one. Let's go to the foundation and put some questions there. And let's see if this foundation is accepted or not. Allah has been saying, الَّذِي خَلَقَ فَسَوَّى خَلَقَ مِنْ عَلَقٍ خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ عَلَقٍ. He created and perfected. He created the human from this and that. He created the heavens, the earth, everything. Now Allah Azza wa Jal, in Surah Al-Mursalat, He begins this second stage of presenting the Aqeedah. In one ayah He says, أَلَمْ نَخْلُقْكُمْ مِنْ مَاءٍ مَهِيمٍ. Look at this. Did not we create you? This is a question. Once you ask the question, you expect a response. Isn't it true that we had created you from a humiliated liquid or water? About the creation of the human? That's a question. Now a question would need a response. Now if you have a response, if you say no, you did not, that's a different story. But then Allah Azza wa Jalla starts putting these questions right there. This is a methodology of the Quran. And then of course he says, فَجَعَلْنَاهُ فِي قَرَارٍ مَكِينٍ إِلَىٰ قَدْرٍ مَعْلُومٍ. And we've made that liquid which was created as a human in an established firm place for a certain time. Okay, this is subject for debate now. Another ayah. أَلَمْ نَجْعَلِ الْأَرْضَ كِفَاتًا. Again question. Because the reason I'm bringing this, because once we start talking about the proofs and ideas and the thoughts of the foundation, someone will come and say, where are you bringing this from? Whose methodology is it? Is it your own way of thinking? That's your logic, that's your sense? Or is it the methodology that Allah Azza wa Jal presented in the Quran? It is the methodology of the Quran. But there are stages and steps for that. So Allah says, أَلَمْ نَجْعَلِ الْأَرْضَ كِفَاتًا. Have not we made the ground as a container? Kifata means a container. Ahya'a wa amwata contains the live as well as the dead. And I will speak about that in more detail. وَجَعَلْنَا فِيهَا رَوَاسِيَ شَامِخَاتٍ. And we have made in this earth, rawasi means confirmers or things like poles that make things fair. Shamikhat means very high, talking about the mountain. Mountains that make the earth so firm that it does not collapse. Didn't we do that? وَأَسْقَيْنَاكُمْ مَاءً فُرَاتًا. And we have made for you a drinkable water, a drinkable water that is that's not salty, desalinated. Sometimes you have to desalinate yourself the water from the seas, and there is a water which is already desalinated. So Allah Azza wa Jalla is making this as a basis of an argument. In Surah Qaf, this is Surah Al-Mursalat. The next surah, immediately, and I'm going in these surahs which I'm going through, this is the sequence of revelation, by the way. Mursalat was revealed after a while after Surah Al-Qalam and Surah Al-Takwir and Surah Al-Duha and Al-A'la, which I've spoken about. Al-Mursalat comes in, then Surah Qaf. Surah Qaf, where Allah Azza wa Jal says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Qaf wal-Qur'an al-Majid, بَلْ عَجِبُوا أَنْ جَاءَهُمْ مُنْذِرٌ مِّنْهُمْ فَقَالَ الْكَافِرُونَ هَذَا شَيْءٌ عَجِيبٌ. Qaf is a letter, Qaf. And by this Qur'an, which is an Arab Qur'an, they have been surprised and astonished to the fact that someone from among them has come as a prophet and as a messenger, and the kuffar said this is a strange issue. أَإِذَا كُنَّا إِذَا مِتْنَا. That's what they are saying now. It's an argument. أَإِذَا مِتْنَا. Once we die. وَكُنَّا تُرَابًا. And we become a soil or a dirt. ذَلِكَ رَجُمْ بَعِيدٌ. Are we going to return back? This is something distant, this is far, this is not acceptable. So some argument now started coming from them. The kuffar now started questioning. Says, إِذَا مِتْنَا, once we die, this Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his God is claiming that we will come back from death. And then we will be revived or revive our life. That's not acceptable. إِذَا مِتْنَا وَكُنَّا تُرَابًا ذلك رجل بعيد. And Allah Azza wa Jal talks to them now. Look at this, how he responds. He says, أَفَلَمْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ فَوْقَهُمْ. Don't they look to the skies above them? كَيْفَ بَنَيْنَاهَا. How we constructed it. وَزَيَّنَّاهَا. And we decorated it. وَمَا لَهَا مِنْ فُرُوجٍ. And it does not have any loophole, any hole, any defect. Has no defect in the construction whatsoever. وَالْأَرْضَ مَدَدْنَاهَا. And the ground we have extended, this earth. وَالْقَيْنَا فِيهَا رَوَاسِيَا. One more time. And we have established some firm mountains in this earth. وَأَنْبَتْنَا فِيهَا مِنْ كُلِّ زَوْجٍ بَهِيجٍ. And we have grown in this ground from every couple, every pair. That is nice. Bahij means nice, that you really love, you like to see. تبصرة وذكر لكل عبد منيب. تبصرة means it's a vision. It's a vision for you to see. Something to look and ponder on. It's an evidence for thought. وذكر, it's a reminder for every slave who comes back to Allah Azza wa Jal. Munib means he returns the ideas and the thoughts within his mind so that he comes back to the facts. It is an evidence. Allah Azza wa Jal is giving evidences now. وَنَزَّلْنَا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً. And we have brought down from the skies, from the heavens, water. مُبَارَكًا. Blessed, plenty, abundant. فَأَنْبَتْنَا بِهَا. And we have grown using this water. We have used it to grow something. جَنَّاتٍ, the garden. وَحَبَّ الْحَصِيدِ, and the grain. وَالنَّخْلَ بَاسِقَاتٍ, and the palm trees, so high. لَهَا طَلْعٌ نَضِيدٌ. It has very nice fruit. رِزْقًا لِلْعِبَادِ, it's food for the people. وَأَحْيَيْنَا بِهِ بَلْدَةً مَيْتًا. And we have given life with this water to a town that has been dead. كَذَلِكَ الْخُرُوجِ. That is the revival of your life. It's an evidence. Allah Azza wa Jal is giving an evidence. I will go through these evidences. Don't rush me. One by one, if you will. And how do they lead to the conclusion that Allah Azza wa Jal wants? I'm here establishing only the methodology of the Quran. That when the people started, later on, at the level or at the time of the Mursalat, and the time of Qaf, which is about 2 to 3 years after the beginning of the Da'wah, when they started questioning the basis of the Aqeedah, Allah Azza wa Jal started bringing these ideas, these issues, these debates, now to the forefront and giving Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the supporting evidence and including in this Quran these arguments. So this Surah Qaf comes along this line. After that comes Surah Al-Balad. And in that Surah, Allah Azza wa Jal is giving the issue about the creation, where he says, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَدٍ. Our creation to the human has come in such a manner that the human is always in difficulty. The human is always striving in a manner of strife. That's an evidence, by the way. In the same surah, he says, أَلَمْ نَجْعَلْ لَهُ عَيْنَيْنِ. Now he's talking about himself with an evidence.
Didn't we give you two eyes?
Now, what brings this evidence? Okay, are these eyes given? Or these are my rights at birth, my birthright as they say it, whether Allah likes it or not, or God likes it or not, whether there is God or there is not, I am as is with two eyes. Or is it the fact that I have two eyes, ونسان and a tongue, وشفتين and two lips, or maybe this is an evidence, the fact that I have the tongue and the two lips and the eyes and of course the rest of the body, these are one of the most visible parts of the human, your eyes. Everybody looks, oh, you have eyes, big, small, nice, bad, you have lips, you have tongue, you talk a lot. It's very visible, and of course the rest of the body, the hair is also from Allah Azza wa Jalla. I've given you a hair, a nose, hands, legs, and so on. But here Allah Azza wa Jalla is emphasizing, isn't it true that I have given you the eyes and the tongue and the lips? That's going into the evidences. In Surah Al-Talaq, that comes after it, still going through the sequence. Okay, and I will continue doing that in most of the sessions, to show you how the sequence of the Qur'an really makes you at least wonder and makes you think that there is a methodology behind this, there is a trend that we are seeing. In Surah Al-Talaq, which comes immediately after Al-Balad, Allah says, فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنْسَانُ مِمَّ خُلِقُ. Let the human look. فَلْيَنْظُرِ. If you have any problems, you have any issues, if you have any doubts, let the human look how he was created, from what were you created. فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنْسَانُ مِمَّ خُلِقُ. خُلِقَ مِنْ مَاءٍ دَافِقُ. خُلِق means he was founded. خُلِقَ means founded, created. There is a creation here. Although some people think it's a continuation, I am not a continuation of my father or my mother. I am a creation. Allah is saying this is a creation. I want you to think about this as a creation. You are being created. Look at you, what were you created from? Look. Think about it. Ponder. فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنْسَانُ مِمَّ خُلِقَ. In Surah Al-Qamar, comes after Al-Talaq, a lengthy surah. Here, there is something new in the Quran that gives us a base for our understanding of the methodology. What he says, وَاتَّبَعُوا أَهْوَاءَهُمْ وَكُلَّ أَمْرٍ مُسْتَمِرٍ. You know why this? Because the ayah says, اقْتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةُ وَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرُ. There is a story behind this. The story is that the people of Mecca, they kept asking Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for some striking evidences that look like the evidences that were at the time of the other prophet. And here Allah Azza wa Jalla, he gave him the split of the moon. The split of the moon, that they would look at it and they would see the moon as being two pieces. Now be it Allah Azza wa Jalla made it some type of vision, some type of gases that would go through between your eyes and the moon such that it appears two, or he would split it or whatever, that's not the story. But the story is that they have seen the people of Mecca, and narrated in tawatur that the people of Mecca, the people of Quraysh, have seen that the moon was split in two halves or two parts. After that, they still continued not to believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Allah revealed وَاتَّبَعُوا أَهْوَاءَهُمْ وَكُلَّ أَمْرٍ مُسْتَمِرٍ. That means they want to follow their desires irrespective of what ayah they see. And the ayah before that, even if you give them whatever ayah, whatever evidence, they are not going to believe. So the issue here now is the mentality of the people. There is something that, because let me mention this very explicit. Sometimes you bring the evidence. You have the very striking evidence, and then the people will continue to shy away. And then you start thinking, is there something wrong in my proof, something wrong in my evidence, something wrong in my presentation? Here Allah Azza wa Jalla is giving us, the defect is not in your proof. The defect is not in your presentation. The defect is not in your way of presenting things. The defect comes from the mentality of the people whom you are talking to.
واتبعوا أهواءهم وكل أمر مستمر.
They have followed their own desires and they chose to overlook the evidences. And this is a very interesting observation that Allah Azza wa Jalla is giving it to us. So when we follow the proofs and the methodology of the Quran and we really work out our arguments and our debates, then at the end of the day, the issue rests in your brain, not in mind. The issue rests in your own desires, not in your own mind. The issue rests in the desires of those who want to reject this faith or this Islam or this ideology. After all, you can present very striking evidence that Islam is the only correct ideology, the only correct religion, the only correct aqidah, the only correct system which has to be implemented, and people still will follow democracy. We'll say, okay, fine. But, you know, let's go with the majority. Let's go with whatever this ruler says or whatever the system says. Okay, اتبعوا أهواءهم. And this is established one more time in the next surah that was revealed, which is Surah Sad, where the people of Mecca, they made this argument with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when eventually they were given with all of these ideas and thoughts about Allah Azza wa Jalla. Look, Allah is the one who created you. Allah has the day of judgment. Allah is Rabbul Alameen. Allah is the one who gives the rizq. Allah is the one this. Allah is the one that. Therefore, there is no reason to worship these idols. These idols are not God. These idols do not deserve to be gods and they cannot be worshipped. So what then? Ah, they said, أَجَعَلَ الْآلِهَةَ إِلَهَا وَاحِدَةً. Is he making the gods one? That's not accepted. إِنَّ هَذَا لَشَيْءٌ عُجَابٌ. This is something very strange. We don't like that. And then they say, أَأُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ الذِّكْرُ مِنْ بَيْنِنَا. Has he been chosen to receive the dhikr among us? That's not accepted. Should have been Abu Jahl the prophet. Abu Lahab should have been the prophet. Al-Walid should have been the prophet. Not Muhammad. أَأُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ الذِّكْرُ مِنْ بَيْنِنَا. From among all of us. The elites of Mecca, the Quraysh, the Taghut, all of these, the big, the rich ones. Muhammad is going to be the prophet? That's not accepted. What is the issue here? بَلْهُمْ, this Allah says, بَلْهُمْ فِي شَكٍ مِّن ذِكْرِ. Indeed, they have doubts about my own dhikr. That means about Allah Azza wa Jalla. Pushing. See the methodology here, let me make this story complete now. And away from my paper. Once I read from the paper, some people get a little bit asleep. But I wanted to establish these issues. Now, the story was like this. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah sends him the Quran. Says, look, ya Muhammad, you are messenger. And I am your God, and I am designating you as a messenger. And I will be from this time on, and as always I have been, I will be the Rabb of this world. Your people in Mecca, the Rabb of all the world. All of these gods are not accepted, null and void. All of these legislators are not accepted. Everything has to come through me. And I will be giving you this Quran and the Sunnah day by day, minute by minute, based on events, whatever you need, I am giving them. And you have to tell the people this issue. So and he started telling the people these issues. Pushing them to the limits. To the limit that, look, the only one who is to be worshipped, Allah. The only Rabb is Allah. The only God is Allah. All of these gods are not gods. Keep pushing them until they have come to the conclusion, they have come to utter it, to say it. بَلْهُمْ فِي شَكٍ مِّن ذِكْرِ. We have doubts. We have doubts, which means we don't believe the basis upon which you are talking. The basis that you are coming from, now we don't believe in them. Now, the approach takes a different or the methodology takes a different approach from this time on. Now I will start giving you the evidences and I will start putting these arguments, and a whole surah like Al-A'raf, which came two or three surahs later after this surah Sad, and surah Al-A'raf, one of the surahs that has most of the evidences that Allah Azza wa Jalla puts in the Quran. Historical evidences, evidences from the creation, about the winds, about the earth, about the moon, about the sun, about the skies, and all of these. If you read Surah Al-A'raf, which is one of the longest surahs in the Quran in Mecca, in fact this is a Surah Makki in Mecca, the longest surah which was revealed in Mecca, Surah Al-A'raf, which was full of evidences.
So until Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was able to push the aqidah issues and the foundation of Islam to the limit and to put them in the ears of the people of Mecca, make them visualize almost every aspect of it, until that time Allah Azza wa Jalla was not providing or was not giving in the Quran those details about why do we say that Allah Azza wa Jalla is the creator, why do we say that the Quran is indeed from Allah Azza wa Jalla, why do we say that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is indeed the prophet and the messenger of Allah. Until that time it was only pushing the ideas to the limit, and that is a methodology that we've got to take. You cannot start with someone telling him, let me prove to you the fact that this world has a beginning and has a creator, and therefore the creator has to be worshipped. You'll tell you, look, I don't have an issue with this. Even if you prove it to him, okay, fine, I accept it. But he's not even listening to you, because he does not think that's the issue. Oh, you worship God, you worship Allah Azza wa Jal, fine. Good for you. And I like that. But look, I'm doing something else. Isn't this exactly what's happening? When we really talk to the people, you know, we talk to about any issue, and even hukum shari'a, about detail, small, salah for example. Somebody is not praying. You'll tell him, okay, brother, sister, why aren't you praying? Aren't you a Muslim? Like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, once he saw somebody in masjid, they made adhan, they made iqama, everybody prayed, and the person was putting his back to the wall and sitting like this, he didn't pray. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asked the question, أَلَسْتَ رَجُلًا مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ? Aren't you one of the Muslim men here? He said, yes, I am a Muslim. Why didn't you pray then? It doesn't make sense. You are a Muslim and you don't pray? Then of course that man, he said, well, I prayed at home and then I came to the masjid. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them, anyway, look, next time, even if you have prayed, do it as a sunnah. Don't just like that. But the issue here is a person who doesn't pray. Why aren't you praying, brother? What's the problem? What's the issue? Aren't you a Muslim? Yes, I am a Muslim. A Muslim means you believe in Allah Azza wa Jal. You believe that Allah is your creator, right? You do, of course. I'm not doubting that. And that Allah Azza wa Jal has to be obeyed, right? And Allah is your God, and therefore you are worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal. All of this is given. You have any doubt about this? No, I don't have any doubt. That's all settled in my mind. Long time ago, I don't even have to think about it. Okay, you don't believe that Allah Azza wa Jal has day of judgment and accountability, and there is Jannah, there is Jahannam, and if you don't pray, you go to Jahannam. Or do you really like to be there? If you don't know the answer, I can pull out a match and burn your hand, just to make you feel what does burn mean. Oh no, I am afraid, I don't like to be buried. Therefore, what's the issue? Oh, the issue, if you keep this argument, you are pushing it, you will reach that limit. بَلْ هُمْ فِي شَكٍ مِنْ ذِكْرِ. There is a doubt. There is some issue here, something not straight. That's the issue. Once you arrive at that conclusion, or maybe the brother or the sister will tell you, okay, you made your point, he made your point, I'm going to take my path and start praying from now on. You made your point, alhamdulillah, jazakallah khair, thank you for reminding me, I've done it. Many people do that. But sometimes, if you keep pushing that, you will come to the conclusion of the next step, as the Quran is bringing it, the next step, let's talk now about that very foundation. Let's talk about Allah Azza wa Jalla. So the issue now is not you, it's not you that you don't want to pray. The issue is that the one whom you are praying to is an issue for you. Only at that time, the issue of the proofs becomes relevant. Only at that time. Before that, the issues of proofs and evidences, they are irrelevant. And not only this, that's not my logic, this is the methodology of the Quran. And this is the reason I went through these surahs right from the very beginning, Iqra al-Muzzammil, al-Muddathir, Noon, Al-A'la, Al-Tariq, Al-Taqwiyat. All of these were following this methodology. I am assuming that you don't have a problem with Allah Azza wa Jalla. I assume that you don't have a problem with the Day of Judgment. I'm assuming that you don't have any problem with this foundation. And based on that, let me tell you what you should do. Even initially to the ones who were kuffar. Kuffar, in the sense that they were worshipping idols. But the assumption was, although you are worshipping this idol, but you do not have an issue in the fact that there is a creator to the world. That's not a problem for you. It just happened that you are worshipping this table instead of worshipping the creator of the table. So let me tell you, stop worshipping this table or this king, this chair or that president, this stone or that prince. Stop worshipping these and start worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal. Now when you refuse to worship Allah, when you refuse to obey Allah Azza wa Jal, when you refuse to obey the command of Allah that Muhammad now is your messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then I would say, okay, looks like you have shakkun fi dhikri, بَلْهُمْ فِي شَكٍ مِّنْ ذِكْرِي or وَاتَّبَعُوا أَهْوَاءَهُمْ. That becomes, once this becomes the issue, once becomes the one that you really have to deal with, then the evidence and the proof becomes imminent. And therefore, once you reach that conclusion, I need to have the proof. Either for me, if I'm the one who is not following, or to be able to carry the doubt. Because sometimes, some people will tell us, brother, why are you spending such big time and lots of details on trying to find what is the proof to the fact that behind this wall there is a creator? Well, if I don't do that, if I don't give these proofs, I will not be following the methodology of the Quran. And after all, the Quran did not stop at Surah Al-Mursalat or before Al-Mursalat. The Quran continued. And after all, we know that how people approach us. And we know the result of our interactions with the people. We know there is a time, always, when the dispute comes all the way, or the debate leads you to the issue of Allah Azza wa Jalla. To the issue of the fact that Allah is indeed the Creator, is indeed the God, is indeed the Rabb, is indeed the one who is behind the universe. Therefore, I need this evidence. And once we do that, it becomes obvious that we are following the methodology of the Quran the way Allah Azza wa Jalla wanted it. That is the issue which I wanted to emphasize today or tonight, to make sure that we are, at least all of us, understand that we are not coming from philosophical perspective. It is not because someone needs the argument or needs the debate, and therefore we need to help him. No, this is the methodology of the Quran. And once you understand that, it becomes an obligation upon us to understand that methodology and to follow it and to be intact with it. And therefore, the next topic out of this would be the proofs as Allah Azza wa Jalla is giving them, using again the Quran and the statements of Allah. As Allah Azza wa Jalla puts in the Quran, فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنسَانُ مِمَّا خُلِقَ. Let the people, let the human think about what he was created from. أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبِلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ. Let them look at the camels, how they were created. وَالسَّمَاءَ بَنَيْنَاهَا وَزَيَّنَّاهَا وَمَا لَهَا مِنْ فُرُوجٍ. And that the skies we have built and constructed, and all of these we will be looking at them in greater detail, inshallah. But now I will open the floor for discussions, for questions, for comments. Let me repeat the question so that the people will... why do we have to prove that there is a methodology for thinking when the thinking procedure is very well known? The thinking mechanism, the procedure of thinking is known, and we will talk about that. In fact, in reality, it's not known. Even the methodology of thinking, tariqah al-tafsir, is not known to the people. Many people don't even know how to think, especially those who have been trained simply to follow and not to think. This is one. The second, it's always important to realize and understand that even in your approach of presenting the ideas and the thoughts about Islam, even the things that have to do with the thinking, that you are still within the methodology of Islam. After all, Islam was brought from scratch to people who did not know anything about this Islam. And Allah Azza wa Jalla was
giving Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba a line, a path on how to present their ideas. So to learn and to understand what is the method of the Quran and the method of the Islam in presenting the ideas in terms of stages is very important, because after all we want to be we want to make sure that we are still along the path of Islam and the methodology of the Quran, which is the best method presented, which proved to be productive. It proved to be productive because Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam produced what the people still thinking about or wanting to do the same. It is very important to be enlightened, if you will, by the method of the Quran and how to present the ideas. That's very important. They say, okay, we are not worshipping these idols as gods, but we want them to take us one step closer to God. وَمَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ الزُّلْفَى. We worship them only to take us one step closer to God. And the response of Allah Azza wa Jalla and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is, when you worship Allah directly, that is, Allah tells you, don't worship them. Allah, the one whom you want to become closer to, says, leave these idols. Which means it breaks every argument. So that's where it comes later on, is every argument that the kuffar have, every argument that disbelievers have, every argument that the Muslims who don't want to follow Islam have, you've got to crush it. Some people have the arguments about nationalism, you want to crush that. People have arguments about patriotism, you want to crush that. People have arguments about democracy, you want to crush that. People have arguments about not being able, too difficult to follow Islam, you want to crush that. So that's, again, the methodology of the Quran tells us that, look, you don't leave any argument without hitting it. Any argument that comes out from the people who want to shy away from Islam, you've got to chase that argument. Evolution, you chase the evolution from the brains of the people. All of these issues, you have to go after them, and that evidence, which is the ayah you wrote, is one along this line. Okay? أَلَمْ نَجْعَلْ. This is an Arabic expression. The Arabic expression of the plural. Plural in Arabic is used, plural, when I say we, does not necessarily mean the group. The word we is a glorification. It's an expression of glorification. That's one expression. The other expression or the other meaning of we is for humbleness. Sometimes, let's say, if I gave someone a present, I would say we gave him a present, so that it would not signify myself as my being, as an individual. That's one way the Arabs use the word plural of nahnu or we. The other one is for glorification, and this is the elites or masters. They would say we decree, which means I, the one who so big, so with glory. So the expression أَلَمْ نَجْعَلْ, when Allah says we have given you عَيْنَيْن, it's not eyes, not ayah, two eyes, that Allah Azza wa Jal is using this expression of glorification. That's not plural. It's not plural in the sense that multiple. See, the plural in English means multiple. In Arabic, the plural of the noun, this is the pronoun, the plural pronoun is for multiple, or for humbleness, or for glorification. Okay? So and whenever Allah Azza wa Jal uses that, it's for glorification. Clear? Enough. Here the question clearly. Is in the society of capitalism, where separation of church and the state is the foundation, is the basis of their belief, then they would say, look, I don't need this God to legislate for me, because I am the human and I am free and I know what's the best for me. If I don't know, I'll consult my brother or sister, and if me and mine, my brother or sister don't know, then we as a whole, as a group, we know what's the best, and whatever comes from us is good enough. Okay? Now, let me tell you how it goes in reality. Because I've used this approach. I've given some lectures in churches, in universities, in some places, and had discussions with people on this issue. And I usually go with the discussion like this. Look, you guys, you don't deny that there is a God, right?
Oh, of course, we don't deny it. There is a God. We accept. But the God has nothing to do with this life. But fine. That's what you say. But now, if God, the one who created you, or created me, and created the world, and created it right from the very beginning, and still sustains it because it still exists, wouldn't have existed, and therefore, the legislations and the laws and the systems and everything that come from God have got to be the correct ones. Have got to be the correct ones. And therefore, anyone, any person who is in his right mind cannot even debate with this issue. God is the creator, therefore his ideas, his laws, his systems are better than mine or yours. That issue, once you put it in this perspective, whether it's in one shot or two shots, this is not subject to debate. They'll say, yeah, okay, of course. But then once you start pushing this idea ahead, that look, therefore, the separation of religion or God, not religion, the separation of the laws of God from this world is not acceptable. That is counterintuitive to the needs of the human himself. Because as a human, I want laws and legislation in order to accommodate my needs and my instincts, to make me live good or live better in this world and in the hereafter. Now, bypassing the laws of Allah Azza wa Jal is counterintuitive. Yes, of course. That's not